Hey guys, welcome to my channel. If you've ever seen bridges stretching for miles, skyscrapers that pierce the clouds, or futuristic high-speed trains racing across the landscape, chances are you've already witnessed China's astonishing infrastructure in action. But today, we're not just here to admire these engineering marvels. We're going to compare them with another global powerhouse, the United States. Why this comparison? Because when it comes to building the future, the world's two largest economies take very different paths. And by the way, don't forget to subscribe and hit the bell icon so you won't miss any of our future videos. So buckle up, let's get started. First, let's take a look at some jaw-dropping numbers from China. As of 2023, China has built over 42,000 kilometers of high-speed rail, more than the rest of the world combined. To put that in perspective, if you connected all that track end-to-end, it would circle the Earth once. And it's not just about the numbers, it's about the speed of construction. Take Beijing Daxing International Airport, for example. With a $12 billion budget and a terminal the size of 97 football fields, the entire project was completed in just 4 years. But this isn't just architecture. It's a national strategy designed to connect 1.4 billion people and energize the economies of all 34 provincial regions. In the US, the picture looks very different. According to the American Society of Civil Engineers, 65% of US roads are in poor or mediocre condition, and over 45,000 bridges need major repairs.
Roads and bridges are vital to the country. The ability to freely move goods, services, and people across our nation directly contributes to our economic place in the world.
There's no question we're not making adequate investments in our transportation infrastructure. It's more expensive today to maintain what we have than it was to build it originally.
We're still driving on roads that my grandparents paid for and built. Our average bridge age is 75 years. Well, they were built to be 50-year bridges. One bridge that carries 90,000 cars a day, the nearest detour is an 11-mile detour. So if that bridge had to shut down, we'd be looking at 1 million miles a day of extra traffic while that bridge was shut down and being rebuilt.
The majority of our population lives in metropolitan areas, so our highways are greatly congested.
When you have congestion problems, time is money, and that's money lost to that business that is trying to get their product to the marketplace. Same thing for a business person whose time is very valuable.
We all work somewhere, and all of those jobs are dependent on that infrastructure working for us.
We need to make some more investments for the future. We have to look at the whole problem.
We have been working for many, many years, over a decade, to bring down the current long structure of a bridge down to street level, to turn that into a boulevard. And of course, the other side of that coin is if you don't invest in your infrastructure and you do have bad roads and you do have bad bridges, it doesn't help you with economic development.
Meanwhile, China's road network quality ranks among the top 30 globally. The difference is even starker in high-speed rail. While China's trains zip at 421 kilometers per hour, the U.S. has no true high-speed rail network. It is shocking and incredible that the latest bullet train developed in China can reach an amazing speed of 603 kilometers per hour. Amtrak's Acela, often called high speed, tops out at just 240 km/h, and that's only on a short stretch between Boston and Washington, D.C. This gap in infrastructure doesn't just highlight differences in engineering capability, it reveals two completely different development philosophies and system advantages. In the U.S., infrastructure has long been trapped in a vicious cycle: political gridlock, funding shortages, and delayed maintenance. Responsibilities between local and federal governments are often unclear, and interstate projects face endless red tape, leaving roads and bridges operating far beyond their intended lifespans, with little hope for timely repair.
We're going to start spending on infrastructure big, and not like we have a choice. It's not like, oh, gee, let's hold it off. Our highways, our bridges are unsafe.
The federal government role in infrastructure is fairly narrow to certain types of things: interstate highways, major roads, and bridges. Infrastructure encompasses much more than that. It includes things like the electric grid, which is privately owned for the most part. It includes water and sewer lines, which are mostly owned by municipalities, local streets. Right now, some of the biggest needs are water and sewer systems in local governments.
Yeah.
Many of those places, like Flint, Michigan, they're very poor cities. If they raise water and sewer rates, it's going to be poor people paying them.
The president has said that not all of the $1 trillion will come from the federal government, that he would like to see private capital also contribute. So is there money in the form of private capital to help with the infrastructure needs in the country? The answer is absolutely yes. The question is, are there attractive returns? Because those investors have many places that they can invest their money.
In terms of basic ways that you can pay for infrastructure, you can simply raise taxes and pay for it with cash. What happens if the toll money falls short? Bonds have to be paid back. Private investors want to make a return. So really, the people who are going to be paying for it is us, either in the form of higher taxes, higher fees, higher tolls. There's just no such thing as free money.
China, on the other hand, leverages its centralized coordination system, allowing for long-term planning and rapid execution. As a result, highways and railways have undergone explosive growth. Today, China's total expressway mileage ranks number one in the world for consecutive years. Its 8 vertical and 8 horizontal high-speed rail grid covers 92% of all cities with over 500,000 residents, creating a half-day living circle in a truly unified national transportation network. What's even more worth noting is how infrastructure is quietly reshaping the economic development models of both nations. In China, the transportation network is deeply embedded into regional coordination strategies. High-speed rail isn't just about getting people from point A to point B. It's fueling industrial upgrades and population mobility along its corridors, helping major initiatives like the Chengdu-Chongqing Economic Circle and the Yangtze River Delta Integration Plan take root and thrive. Meanwhile, in the U.S., aging infrastructure has kept logistics costs stubbornly high, limiting the economic potential of the Midwest and widening the gap between regions.
The Department of Transportation estimates that the U.S. needs to spend at least $124 billion a year to keep roads and bridges in good condition. In 2010, all levels of government combined only spent $100 billion, $24 billion short.
This contrast reveals a deeper truth. World-class infrastructure isn't just a hard asset, it's also a form of soft power that defines national competitiveness. While China is already planning for intelligent railways and magnetic levitation trains, the U.S. is still stuck debating how to fix what's already broken. This generational gap in infrastructure development may have only just begun to show. Cost is another major factor. China's Three Gorges Dam, the largest hydroelectric project in the world, was completed in just 17 years. The Three Gorges Dam, because it has an exceptionally large solid granite river valley. In the first segment of the river, about 1 million square kilometers of land has been taken under control, and the average amount of water passing through the river each year reaches 500 billion cubic meters. It is the world's most gigantic concrete structure. It took 40,000 employees. They needed nearly 6 billion gallons of concrete and 463,000 tons of steel, which is enough to construct 63 Eiffel Towers. They installed 32 huge generators that weigh 6,000 tons each. With the activation of these 32 generators, the Three Gorges Dam has reached its full capacity. These 32 main turbines, each with a capacity of 700 megawatts and two small turbines, each with a capacity of 50 megawatts, can generate enough electricity to run 15 nuclear reactors, weigh enough to provide energy for 60 million people. The total cost? According to China, it costs $37 billion to complete the project. Now compare that to California's high-speed rail. Back in 2008, it was originally budgeted at $33 billion. But today, the price tag has soared to nearly $128 billion. And after 15 years, only a small portion of the rail line is finished. So why such a massive gap? In China, centralized planning allows for faster land acquisition and streamlined approvals. In the U.S., infrastructure projects often get stuck in years of lawsuits, community opposition, and political gridlock.
What is the state of infrastructure in this country today?
We are really falling behind and falling apart.
Marsha Hale is with the bipartisan group Building America's Future, which raises awareness of the state of U.S. infrastructure.
We've got a construction site right ahead of us here.
The American Society of Civil Engineers gave the U.S. a D-plus for overall infrastructure this year after a comprehensive review that included the nation's roads, bridges, and waterways. Their solution? Invest an estimated $3.6 trillion by the year 2020.
Our roads, our bridges, our schools.
It is also time to rebuild our crumbling infrastructure.
America, this is how we truly build back better.
China is also leapfrogging in tech. Their floating tunnels and 3D printing technology are pushing engineering boundaries, while U.S. infrastructure often relies on decades-old technology. For example, China's Beidou navigation system, a rival to GPS, powers smart infrastructure projects nationwide, from traffic management to disaster prevention. So it means that precision guidance systems cannot be controlled or jammed by the U.S. anymore. The ICAO has now recognized China's Beidou navigation system as a global standard for civil aviation, which is more accurate than the American GPS. The fact is that the Beidou system has already been used worldwide and has an astronomical number of users. In the U.S., many cities still struggle to upgrade basic systems, like lead pipes and water supply networks. What drives these differences? It boils down to policy, funding, and culture. China's five-year plans allocate massive state funding to infrastructure, while the U.S. depends more on fragmented local budgets and private investment. Culturally, China values long-term planning, as seen in projects like the Belt and Road Initiative, which aims to connect Asia, Europe, and Africa over decades. In contrast, U.S. infrastructure often prioritizes short-term political goals, leading to delays and budget overruns.
Just a few years ago, the stock market's at 25,000, corporate profits are the highest they've been in decades, the rich keep getting richer, and our friends on the other side said, what do we do now? Let's do a tax cut where 83% of it goes to the top 1% of the wealthiest people. Fast forward a few months, global pandemic, 36 million people unemployed, 40% of families who have a worker that makes $40,000 a year and less lose their job last month. 4 million people didn't pay their rent, and the Republican Party says, we don't have any money to help you. Are you kidding me? Where do you guys live? Food lines around the blocks at our food banks in the United States of America. 1 in 5 kids are going hungry. Your party can't even get food to them. This isn't a wish list. If it's a wish list, it's for the working class people.
So, who's winning the infrastructure race? The answer isn't simple. China's rapid growth has raised concerns about environmental impact and debt risks, while the U.S. is finally investing billions in the bipartisan infrastructure law.
After years and years of infrastructure week, we're on the cusp of an infrastructure decade that I truly believe will transform America.
The $1.2 trillion bill includes $550 billion in new spending, including $110 billion for roads and bridges, $25 billion for airports, and the largest federal investment in broadband ever, $60 billion. All of this is extremely important and needed, with the biggest investment in bridges since the interstate system. With former Vice President Harris presiding, all 50 Senate Democrats voted to support the bill, along with 19 Republicans, including Minority Leader Mitch McConnell. It's a good day. Elections matter. But the bipartisan spirit in the Senate was gone by lunchtime, with Democrats taking their first procedural vote on a separate $3.5 trillion budget bill packed with other priorities that they intend to pass in the face of united Republican opposition. This budget resolution is a dream for those who want to socialize America. It's a nightmare for working people. But one thing's clear, the way these two giants build their futures will shape global economics, trade, and technology. In the field of hydraulic engineering, China has also achieved global acclaim. The South to North Water Diversion Project, the largest water transfer system in the world, aims to alleviate severe water shortages in northern and northwestern China. Divided into three routes, eastern, central, and western, the project reallocates abundant southern water resources to water-scarce regions across the country. The total length of the engineering project is 1,100 kilometers, and the total investment exceeds $62 billion U.S. dollars. To date, The project has transferred hundreds of billions of cubic meters of water, benefiting hundreds of millions of people, while effectively improving ecological conditions and the overall quality of life in the North. Throughout the construction process, engineers face major technical challenges, such as tunneling under the Yellow River and managing expansive soils. Yet through persistent research and innovation, Chinese engineers overcame these difficulties and ensured the successful completion of this national megaproject. China's rapid rise in infrastructure, it's no accident. Behind it, a deep foundation in science and technology and a vast reserve of skilled professionals. The country boasts a massive team of highly qualified researchers, engineers, and technicians who continuously drive innovation in the infrastructure sector. At the same time, China's industrial system powers the build. From cutting-edge materials to precision machines, it delivers at scale. In addition, China's infrastructure boom didn't happen by chance. It was driven by long-term government planning, strong policies, and massive public investment. One successful megaproject after another. Compared to the United States, China has demonstrated a unique set of advantages and growing competitiveness in infrastructure development. While the U.S., once a pioneer in global infrastructure, now struggles with aging facilities, funding shortfalls, and bureaucratic delays, many of its roads, bridges, and railways are in disrepair and badly in need of upgrades. In contrast, China continues to invest heavily, accelerate innovation, and complete projects with unmatched speed and precision. Its infrastructure model not only supports robust domestic development, but also offers a valuable reference for other countries seeking to modernize their own systems. And the story is far from over. The miracle of Chinese infrastructure continues to unfold. In the years ahead, China is poised to explore ever deeper underground engineering, expand transportation networks to new frontiers, and take on construction challenges in even more complex environments. With fearless determination and world-class technical expertise, China is reshaping the very definition of what human engineering can achieve, paving the way for a future that is stronger, smarter, and more interconnected than ever before. Do you think China's model can work in other countries? Or does the U.S. have an ace up its sleeve? Don't forget to subscribe and hit the bell icon for more deep dives like this one. Thanks for watching.